Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'een. Welcome, brothers and sisters, to this session, Dawah, the Prophetic Mission. Inshallah, we have a number of speakers in this session, and the session will conclude with a Q&A session. So inshallah, the next presenter is Imam Suhaib Webb. He is a leading American scholar and adjunct assistant professor of public service. And inshallah, the title of his presentation today is The Delusion of This Life.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأزكى صلاة وأفضل التسليم على سيد الأولين الذي بعثه الله سبحانه وتعالى حجة وجعله صلى الله عليه وسلم رحمة اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه في الأولين وفي الآخرين وفي الملأ الأعلى يا رب العالمين. We praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We send peace and blessings upon our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, upon his blessed family, his companions, and those who follow them until the end of time. Alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. MashaAllah, it's great to be with all of you, especially with our brothers and sisters at ICNA. And in the spirit of Dawah, I think it's very important to note that in 1992, I was walking in a market and somebody actually gave me a pamphlet that said Islam at a Glance. And that pamphlet had been produced, alhamdulillah, by ICNA. That was one of the first pieces of literature outside of other things that I had read really about Orthodox Islam, alhamdulillah. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to bless the great efforts of ICNA, and to increase, inshallah, the khair that ICNA does, and inshallah, to encourage us through very difficult, interesting times to maintain our commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The question that, or the topic that I was given was the delusion of this life. We know in numerous places in the Quran, in Surah Al-Hadid, also in Surah Yunus, you know, إِنَّمَا مَثَلُ حَيَاتِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَا إِنْ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. Surah Yunus, like the example of this life, is like water that comes from the heavens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَعِبٌ وَلَهُمْ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ وَتَكَاثُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ كَمَثَلِ غَيْثٍ أَعْجَبَ الْكُفَّارَ نَبَاتُهُ ثُمَّ يَهِيجُ فَتَرَاهُ مُصْفَرًّا ثُمَّ يَكُونُ حُطَامًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. Right? Surah Al-Hadid also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likens this dunya to the rain that falls from the heaven, this worldly life, this temporary life. And what comes is, of course, this beautiful vegetation that's actually our youth. And then that begins to slowly turn yellow and fade away, and that's the life process. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that in the akhirah, in the hereafter, is either going to be reward or punishment. In the life of the da'iyah, in the life of the caller, perhaps one of the foundational principles, as I heard from one of our teachers, Dr. Hassan Shafi, great scholar, a great professor from Darul Uloom, great Azhari Sheikh in Egypt, he talks about that there are certain foundational principles that Muslims should live by. And one of those is keeping the hereafter in front of ourselves. As Al-Muhasibi said, وَإِجْعَلْ الْآخِرَ مَطِيعَتَكَ. Make the akhirah like your mount. Like make it what you ride through this world. Like keep it in front of you. And it's so important that Imam Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, he says that the akhirah is mentioned on almost every page of the Quran. Subhanallah. Maliki yawmi ddin, Surah Al-Fatiha. The next page, wa bil akhirati hum yuqinun. The next page after that, you know, wa lahum adhabun arimun bima kanu yukadhibun. And the next page, wa quduha an-nasu wal hijara. The next page, wa bashshiril ladhina amanu wa aminu salihat. The next page is actually like the story of how we lost Jannah, subhanallah, and how we long to return. So on almost every page of the Quran, the hereafter is mentioned because of its importance and the centrality that it should play in the life of the faithful, and in particular, the da'iyah, the caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that da'wah is very important. It's from the sunan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says very beautifully, وَاللَّهُ يَدَعُوا إِلَى دَارِ سَلَامِ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. So to Yunus, Allah calls to Jannah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, we find that, you know, even shaitan, a'udhu billah, he has da'wah. الشيطان يعيدكم الفقر ويأمركم بالفحشاء. He calls you to fear poverty and he calls you to see evil. So we understand now that it is from the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call us to good. And also there is the other side of this coin, that there is a call to evil. That's why Imam Ibn Qayyim said, كل عبد يقف بين الأذانين. Everybody sits between two adhans, the call to what's good and the call to what's evil. One of the things that I hear sometimes from Muslims is that they don't feel that they are responsible for da'wah. You know, I'm just, you know, whatever, I'm not the best Muslim, whatever, I got some issues. But first and foremost, you have to realize, just by being Muslim, you are making da'wah, subhanAllah. Your presence is a presence of da'wah. The second is that the Quran commands us to be people who call to good and refrain others and rebuke evil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim. Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashiran wa nadhira wa da'iyan ila Allahi bi'iznihi wa sirajan munira. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the Prophet is a da'iyah. He's a caller. Wa sirajan munira, and a torch. Al-Razi, the great mufassir, he said, why is the Prophet called a torch? Because in ancient times, a torch was spread from one tribe to another. The fire was spread. So the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to be spread by the torch, and this is his ummah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he describes this ummah, when it's doing its job correctly, as being a religious community that calls to the good and forbids the evil. That's why he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnasi ta'muruna bil ma'rufi wa tanhawna 'anil munkari wa tu'minuna billah. That you are the best ummah, and also this is called tanbihul khitab, meaning that Allah mentions certain characteristics which imply that they are actually conditions that have to be met for the good ummah to exist. What are those two characteristics? That you constantly call to good, you command the good, and you forbid the evil. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fardu ain on everybody depending on their knowledge, when he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, balighu anni walau aya, you have to relate for me even if it's one verse. And also, subhanallah, we have a very important principle in usul fiqh, at-ta'akhur 'an al-bayan la muhal, that it is not allowed for you or I as a Muslim, if there is an opportunity to clarify something or bring someone to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should be strategic, of course. But if there's that strategic opportunity, we are commanded by Allah to seize it. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُمُونَ مَا أَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالْهُدَى مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا بَيَّنَّاهُ لِلنَّاسِ فِي الْكِتَابِ أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّاعِنُونَ. صَلَّى بِالْعَافِيَةِ. That those people who hide what Allah has sent Allah and the angels and humanity cursed them. وَإِذْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ مِيثَاقَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ تُبَيِّنُوا لَهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَهَا وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَهُ. There's actually two qira'ah here. Qira'ah of Sayyidina Hafs and Sayyidina Sha'ba, and then of course Sayyidina Wash and Imam Nafi' Qalun al-Nafi', where the actual tense of the qira'ah changes. Where subhanAllah, Allah begins by talking to Ahlul Kitab, that you were told not to hide anything. And then the tense switches in Sha'ba, and also one of the narrations of Sayyidina Nafi', to say, you Ummah of Muhammad, you are forbidden to hide it as they hid it. Allahu Akbar. So kitmanul ilmi wa kitmanul haqim la yujuz. That's why one of the qualities of the prophets, Sheikh al-Marzuqi al-Maliki, in Aqidat al-Awam, one of the foundational poems we learn in Aqidah, he says about the Anbiya, أَرْسَلَ أَنْبِيَاءَ ذَوِي فَطَارَ بِصِدْقِ وَالتَّبْلِيغِ وَالْأَمَانَ, that the prophets, the four qualities we believe about them, they're truthful, they're honest, and بَلَّغْ مَا أُنزِلْ. بَلَّغُ, they related everything Allah commanded them. They were du'at. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ma'idah, يا أيها الرسول بلغ ما أنزل إليك من ربك فإن لم تفعل فما بلغت رسالته. Again, two قراءة. فما بلغت رسالته فما بلغت رسالاته. From the seven قراءات, which means, O Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, بلغ, convey everything Allah has commanded you to convey. Because if you don't, you will not have related two different qira, his message or his messages. Because since Sayyidina Muhammad is Khatib al-Anbiya, if he were to not, a'udhu billah, relate anything Allah commanded to him, it would be as though we lost something from all of the prophets, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In order to be that type of person, someone has to live for something greater than the temporary world. And that's why a key foundation in the life of someone who is a da'iyah is to be attached and connected to the hereafter and not to this dunya. And that's why the verse, actually, there is some nuance that Sayyidina Imam al-Tabari, he mentions when he says, you know, وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ, and so on and so forth. He said, yes, the dunya is a delusion for those who don't know how to use it. And the delusion is lahu, like the delusion is a waste of time for those who don't know how to use it. But as for the da'iyah, and as for the believer, and this is the first quality of someone who believes in the hereafter, is that they are not attached to the dunya, but they know how to utilize the dunya to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah says, لا تنسى نصيبك من الدنيا. Don't forget your share of the dunya. And that's why one of our mashaykh in Masr used to say, الدنيا كبري للآخرة, if you understand Egyptian, that the dunya is a bridge to the hereafter. And that's why, subhanallah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a good hadith related by Sayyidina Tirmidhi, he said, خيركم من رزق كفافة, the best of you who your provisions are sufficient. Islam does not believe in opulence. And this is the danger now of the Instagram age and the TikTok age and being constantly exposed to the glitz of this world, that if we're not careful, we can be deceived. وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ, right? Don't be deceived by this dunya. We can be deceived by it, but the believer is somebody who sees through it. That's why it's called tadabbur. Adubur is the back. So as though someone, I think about the dunya, I see it from the front, I end up at the back. Most people, they stay in a shallow space, but the believer is the one who can think through it. Subhanallah. So the first is that we should understand that Islam does not encourage us to be opulent, to seek opulence, but to seek sufficiency. And that's why the hadith that I just mentioned from Sayyidina Imam al-Tirmidhi, faqad hassanahu, that the Prophet said, the best of you are those who have sufficient means. So that's why a Muslim should be working to have an education, to have a career, to have a hustle, to have something that is going to allow him or her to be autonomous. Because when the da'iyah, and we see this now in the Muslim world, where the mashaykh are paid for by dictatorships and governments, and this is how they enslave them. As the former king of Morocco used to say, the thirsty dog can only beg for water. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim. Whereas, subhanAllah, somebody that has some kind of financial independence is going to be able then to maintain their autonomy. That's why Sayyidina Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal, when he was asked about what are the conditions of a mufti, one of them he said is sufficiency, that they should be autonomous. And Sufyan al-Thawri, he used to say, مَالُ الْمُؤْمِنْ سِلَاحُهُ فِي عَصْرِنَا. Sufyan al-Thawri, who opposed the government and stood against a corrupted government in an autocratic system in his lifetime, he said that the weapon of the believer is sufficient wealth. And Sayyid ibn Musayyib, the Imam of the Tabi'een, said, لا خير, there's no good in somebody who doesn't have sufficient wealth so he can protect his family and his deen and pay off his debts. So the first, we want to think about how faith in the Akhirah should help us to think about building a da'wah, is that I should be sufficient financially and I should be independent, bi'ithnillah. The second is I should be willing to sacrifice and make efforts, because I know that the dunya is not the end. وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ, what's with Allah is going to last. And that's why, subhanAllah, we see the da'iyah in Surah Yasin, this volunteer who's not even a prophet, who steps up to help these prophets. فَعَزَّزَنَاهُمَا بِثَالِثٍ, Allah sent three prophets to them, and those people rejected those three prophets. And then we see, وَجَاءَ مِنْ أَقَلْسَ الْمَدِينَةِ رَجُلٌ يَسْعَى قَالِيَ قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُوا الْمُرْسَلِينَ. he's not a leader, but he's willing, and this is the third thing, to be able to volunteer, not always have to be the head of the show, not always having to be the main star, also be a supporter, be an ansar. So this man, he doesn't have any ego, and he runs and he flees to help those prophets. The point is very beautiful because we know he was killed by his people. قال يا قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي وجعلني من المكرمين. After he died and he was tortured and he died in his grave, he says, oh, I wish I could go back and tell my people how Allah has blessed me. Ibn Abbas, رضي الله عنهما, look at the passion of the da'iyah. He said, da'ahum fi dunya. He called them while he was alive, and he wished even after his death, he could call his people because he loved his people and he loved da'wah. The third thing is that someone involved in da'wah should have a shaykh, should have a teacher, should have a marja, should have a reference. Outside of YouTube, outside of course, we have to do our best, but there should be someone that they're consulting with from the people of ilm. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And when we mean the people of ilm here, we mean the people who are trained. Not volunteers, not people, maybe they did some self-study, mashallah, this is great. But we need people who are able, التبحر بعلوم الشريعة. And they are not partisan, they are not, you know, overly fanatical about their group, but they try to help guide this person according to the foundations of Sharia and the maqasid of Islam. This is a great lesson we take from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Actually, the two lessons that are found in this hadith, I mentioned one of them earlier, and that is, number one, a person should be sufficient. That's why in the hadith of Sayyidah Aisha radiyallahu anha, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to Ghari Hira, he used to take provisions. For Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdullah Darraz al-Azhari, great scholar, mashallah, died in Lahore, Pakistan, in 1952, he said that the Prophet used to take his provisions. This is a proof that da'iyah should have sufficiency. The other point that I just made is that the da'iyah should have a teacher. So we see that Sayyidina Imam Abdullah Darraz, he mentions in the hadith of Sayyidah Aisha, indama ashkala alayhi al-amr, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the beginning, he needs to understand more, he goes to Waraqa ibn Nawfal. And we know that, mashallah, Warqa ibn Nawfal, he said, you know, ya laytani, I wish I was young, I could help you. Yukhrijuka qawmu qala mukharijim qarana. So here we see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has a shaykh. And also Sayyidina Jibreel, kan yati wa yu'allimuhu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Jibreel, he used to teach him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If I'm calling to Allah and I'm not consulting the people of knowledge, I may be making mistakes. And this happens in two ways. Number one is irrational, unrealistic, irresponsible conservatism. So people attack in du'at. Now we see our Imam Omar Suleiman being attacked by people. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah aliyyil azim. If there was like some foundational knowledge, if there was some mashaykh, if there were some teachers to advise people, they would explain to him, for example, the hadith of Ibn Abi Shayba, which is not a sahih, that a sahaba said there's nothing wrong to say ameen when the non-Muslims are praying. This hadith is sahih, one of the sahabi, excuse me, said the hadith from Musnad ibn Abi Shayba, that it's not wrong to say ameen when the monks say ameen. And somebody asked the sahabi, how can you say that? He said, well, maybe what they are asking is not answered by their God, but if there's good in it and you say ameen, Allah will answer you. Subhanallah, hadha nas. If you were to say this in front of most people, they will kill you. That's why some of the ulama said that the ulama of the Muslim community to the Muslims are like the Prophet's word to Bani Israel. They will slaughter them. That's why Abu Ala al-Mu'arri, the great alim, he said, فَلَمَّا رَأَيْتُ الْجَهْلَ فَاشِحًا تَعْلَمْتُ حَتَّى يُقَالُ أَنِّي جَاهِلُ. He said, when I realized that the masses didn't know Islam, I learned Islam. And I knew I learned Islam when the masses said I was ignorant, because I knew and they didn't know. The last point, inshallah, after having a teacher, because the outcome of a teacher is balanced, is that we should think about, as we head to the hereafter, the importance of coalition building and strategically working with others. This is very, very important, because if somebody is trying to head to the hereafter, they're going to realize that they need help, that they're limited. That's why it's Ashabul Jannah, right? The group of people in Jannah. And for this, we see two important points. Number one is working with the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, al-mu'minun wal-mu'minat ba'duhum awliya'u ba'd. Right? That the believing men and women, they are helpers of one another. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, an-nisa shaqa'iqu, an-nisa'u shaqa'iqu rijal. Hadha hadith sahih rawah ibn Majah. That women are the helpers of men, that they help one another in khayr. And then also working with non-Muslims. We know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on Hijrah, his guide was a non-Muslim. And people used to ask, man hadha qala hadha dalili. They used to ask, who's that? He said, this is my guide. And here he is called Tawri in Arabi. He doesn't mean literally my guide, but people, they didn't understand. But he meant the person who was leading him, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. We find a hadith, kama rawahu al-Bukhari. And this hadith is very important. People should know it. And Imam Ibn Qayyim in Zad al-Ma'ad, he dedicates really a long discussion on this issue. And that is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his camel was headed to Mecca, his camel stopped al-Qaswa. And the Sahaba, they begin to tease him. He said, ma khuliqat li, she wasn't created for this. Then he pointed to Mecca, and this is at the height of the hatred the Meccans have for the Prophet. Allah says, "Wahamma bi qatli." You know, they wanted to kill him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He says, if those people, if they ask me to work with them, to organize with them, we can understand in contemporary language, on what's good, siratul rahim, family issues, or sha'ir Allah, or something sacred, I will work with them. It's interesting to note that one of the more conservative scholars is Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, who led this movement. And Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, in his explanation of Zad al-Ma'ad, he said, this text is a proof that Muslims can partner with any community, with any group of people, as long as it doesn't compromise their religion, and it maintains one of the foundations of Islam. So alhamdulillah, we talk about belief in the hereafter. It's going to be translated now, and there's more, but looks like we're running out of time. Alhamdulillah, I have my apologies. I'm looking at the screen, but I need my glasses. I didn't see any warnings, but it's good to see our brother's face. Alhamdulillah. That belief in the hereafter, number one, should cause me to think about being autonomous so I can protect myself for the hereafter. Number two, it should cause me to make sacrifice and effort, right? Number three, I should then think about strategic partnerships and working with people. Number four, I should see a sheikh or a teacher, because the sheikh or teacher is going to be the one who helps me live, inshallah, for the hereafter. And in this regard, our sheikh Imam Omar has written a very good book. I encourage you to check it out, on the hadith related to Muslim activism. So I encourage us to support the great work that ICNA is doing to protect and look after the legacy and dignity of our fellow imams and leaders with also dignity. Barakallahu feekum wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa sallamu alaikum.
JazakAllah khair, Imam Suhaib. So inshallah, we are short on Q&A, but I'll just ask one very quick question to Imam Suhaib. There are many ways to serve Allah. In your view, what do you think makes Dawah a very special opportunity to serve Allah above and beyond maybe other ways of serving?
No, I mean, I think, mashallah, the brother that spoke before me, I think Hernan is his name, forgive me if I'm saying your name wrong, Akhi Sheikh. I think what he said is absolutely right on point, right? Like the Prophet, in yahdika Allahu bika rajul wahid khayru laka min humrin na'am. The Prophet said to Sayyidina Ali karramallahu wajha, if Allah guides one person for me, it's better than anything. وَمَنْ دَلَّ عَلَى خَيْرٍ فَلَهُ أَجْرُ مِثُ فَاعِلِ. Whoever follows someone in goodness, the one they follow, they're going to get the reward for it. مَنْ سَنَّ سُنَّ حَسَنَةً. So the fact that this is better than Bitcoin, you know what I mean? Like, if you, Allah blesses you to guide someone, then what they do, you will share in the reward with them. And of course, the hadith, all the actions of people are cut off except three. And one of them is this kind of effort. So, you know, when you're thinking about living for the hereafter, one of the best ways to cash in. I was thinking that he was talking and he said, mashallah, one of his children was hafiz. Can you imagine the person who, subhanAllah, was guided, Allah used to guide you, like your child's effort, your work and effort, that person also is going to share in the reward, mashallah. So, I mean, I think that's That's the price.
Jazakallah khair. So with that, we are out of time for this session. One thing I would like to end with is simply to say that many people are asking the question, well, how do we do dawah during COVID-19 with lockdown, with socially distanced, what do we do? On some of the work ICNA is doing to mail out postcards to some of the remote areas in the country, try and get the message of Islam, the invitation to Islam to people, and to complement those mailing efforts with social media campaigns targeted to the same regions, inshallah. So I'd like to end by thanking all of the speakers for the fantastic presentations and the words of inspiration. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to act on these words. Please do donate something for the work of Dawah. Please do volunteer for getting involved in some of the Dawah initiatives that are available to you.